Hi, everyone, and welcome to the fifth event of Democracy Matters. I'm Ran, a professor of economics here at Stanford, and thank you all so much for joining us today. It is an honor and a pleasure to see the Stanford community come together around this event series, and I'm especially delighted to see so many students engaged with the challenges facing the US as we approach the elections, including the 300 undergraduate students who are taking this event series as a course and are doing or will be doing weekly readings on democracy and on inequality, immigration, healthcare, racial injustice, and other topics that we cover here during the event. Last week, we talked about inequality and the American dream, and today we are going to talk about immigration and the American dream. Now, immigration is an important issue in the upcoming US elections, and it tends to be a divisive topic. People tend to form opinions about immigration based on stories and fear rather than based on evidence and facts. And so a main goal of today's event is to bring facts and evidence on the immigration debate. So today, actually, I will start by talking about my own research on immigration and the American dream over two centuries. And I'm especially excited to host three amazing colleagues who are great experts on immigration in the United States. Anna Minian from History will talk about the return of immigration detention. Asad from Sociology will talk about deportation threat and daily life. And Melanie Morten from Economics will talk about the potential implications of building a border wall. And so each of us, as usually, will talk for 10 minutes and we will follow with Q&A from the audience. Now, you don't have to wait until the end to type your questions, and you can just use the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen throughout the event, and we will answer as many of your questions as time allows us at the end. All right, so let me share my screen. All right, so I am going to talk today, in the 10 minutes I have, about a book project that I'm working on with my longtime collaborator and friend, Leah Bustan from Princeton. And the idea is to bring data and long-term perspective on the immigration debate that is typically based on fear and anecdotes rather than on facts. And much of the book is comparing the experience of immigrants today with the experience of immigrants in the past. Like the ones you can see here in the picture, these immigrants in this picture are waiting to be processed in Ellis Island. None of them required a visa or a passport to enter the United States, nor did they have to prove that they have a family or a job waiting for them in the United States. And they were part of the age of mass migration between 1850 and 1914. About 30 million immigrants came from Europe to the United States in one of the largest migration episodes in modern history. The borders were nearly open to European migrants. They were definitely not open to Asian immigrants, and the 1882 Chinese Exclusion Act, for example, was the first law in the United States that excluded people based on their ethnic origins from entering the United States. We often hear these nostalgic views about these past immigrants and how quickly they assimilated into the US society and integrated into the US economy. And this is often contrasted with how immigrant groups today are not able to assimilate and integrate into the United States. And we chose this title, Streets of Gold, because like an immigrant, maybe 130 years ago, 120 years ago, maybe an Italian immigrant said something like, I came to America because I heard the streets there were paved with gold. And when I arrived, I found out three things. First, the streets weren't paved with gold. Second, they weren't paved at all. And third, I was expected to pave them. So this is exactly what this book is trying to do. Over the last 15 years, we have put together large, big data sets to bring some evidence on the immigration debate and to reassess some of the common myths we have about immigration and the American dream over the last two centuries. And so in this, maybe a word about the data collection here. The think, you know, the best way, you know, we collect data on millions of immigrants. How do we do that in the past? Well, the easiest way to think about it is imagine searching for your own grandfather in the U.S. Census and in official records, and you go, you find their names, you find where they lived, you find whether they were married and what they were doing for a living, what was their income, and then you look them up again in the next census. Maybe you look at their children, you see how their children are doing, and so think about this grandson doing this research, and now multiply this by millions. So we look for millions of immigrants in the United States censuses, and we follow them and over time, and we create these genealogies of people and their children that we can track over time. And then, you know, once we assemble the data, we can start to ask questions like, well, is it really true that past immigrants who came to the United States assimilate that quickly into the U.S. society and economy? How about their children? Who did they get married with? You know, like, how did they name their children? Where did they live? When did they arrive to the United States? And so on. So I want to, maybe let me start by giving you a little bit of like a bird's eye view of immigration in American history over the last 150 years. This is what we call in the book, the immigration U in US history. And we constructed this figure by looking at the US censuses, and we calculated the share of foreign born in the United States. So think about it, the share of people who reported being born overseas in the United States population. So today, there are about 45 million immigrants in the United States, and immigrants account for about 14% of the U.S. population. Now, immigrants accounted for 14% of the U.S. population for about 50 years during the age of mass migration. Then, in the 1920s, this era of open borders came to an end, first with the literacy test in entering the United States in 1917, followed by strict immigration quotas that were imposed in the 1920s that heavily favored immigrants from Western and Northern Europe over immigrants from Southern and Eastern Europe. Then in the interwar period, we see very little migration, with some important exceptions like the Bracero program, individuals displaced by World War II, but overall immigration remained quite low all the way until the 1960s. Then in 1965, the Immigration and Nationality Act abolished these country-specific quotas and increased the number of immigration quotas substantially. But of course, the demand for immigration is still larger than the number of visas issued, and this gave rise to immigrants that are undocumented, which is a phenomenon that did not really exist in the past because most immigrants were registered legally in the United States. In terms of countries of origin, the sending countries changed dramatically as well in the United States. So if you look at 1850s and 1860s, 90% of immigrants were from Western and Northern Europe. So places like the British Isles and Germany and Scandinavian countries. But in 1890, immigrants from Southern and Eastern Europe, like Italy and Russia, started to come in larger numbers. And by the time the border closed in 1920, about 40% of the immigrant stock was from Eastern Europe. Today, of course, Europe is no longer a main sending region of immigrants to the United States, and 75% of immigrants are from Latin America, mainly Mexico, and from Asia. So I had a hard time thinking about what it is that I should talk about in the few minutes that I have. And then I saw this tweet a few days ago from a candidate to the US Senate, and it reads, "Most third world migrants cannot assimilate into civil societies. Prove me wrong." So I decided to take the challenge and show our research finding that proves her wrong. And I'm really doing it with the hope that evidence can change people's mind. And of course, Lauren is not the only one who have this concern. Here is from the US president. "Assimilation has been very hard. It's almost, I won't say non-existent, but it gets to be pretty close. And I'm talking about second and third generation. For some reason, there's no real assimilation." And of course, there is nothing new under the sun. Here is a quote from 1891 from Henry Cabot Lodge, a senator with a Harvard PhD in history, who was the one of the architects of the Dillingham Commission report in the, that eventually put an end to immigration in the 1920s. And he said, immigrants are from races most alien to the body of the American people and from the lowest and most illiterate classes of these races. So I'm just putting here these quotes to say that we see very similar concerns about immigrants today and in the past, only they are targeted at different immigrant groups. So let me just show you one finding. You know, I don't have time to show you a lot. One finding related to children of immigrants in the United States. And this is a work that Leah and I are doing together with Elisa Giacome and Santiago Perez. And we put together data on, again, millions of immigrants, both in the past and today. And we find that children of immigrants are doing quite well. In fact, they are more upwardly mobile than the children of US born. Now, this is true both in the past and present. And despite all the changes in immigration policy in the United States, despite all the changes in sending countries, this is true both in the past and today. And it is true for immigrants from nearly every sending country. So let me give you like just briefly what we find. So let's start with the past, okay? So we take, imagine we take the population censuses, we take the census of 1910, we see the parents, we see how the parents are doing, we link the parents to their children 30 years later, we then see how their children are doing in 1940. And then, of course, you know, when people say that immigrants aren't doing very well, they don't really mean the rich immigrants, so they typically mean the poor immigrants. So I'm showing you here poor immigrants, children of immigrants who are born to the working poor, if you want, to families at the 25th percentile of the income distribution. And so what I'm showing you here is the average income rank for children born to families at the 25th percentile of the income distribution. What do we find? The children of poor immigrants are doing very well. In fact, they were more upwardly mobile than the children of US born from nearly every sending country. So the children of immigrants are more, if you think about it, the children of poor immigrants are more likely to enter into the middle class than the children of US born. When we investigate in the data about why that is, it's not that we find that the children of, that immigrants say invest more in their education of their children. The children of immigrants are not more educated than the children of US born in the past, but what we find is that immigrant parents tended to move to areas that offer upward mobility to everyone. So in the past, it meant mostly that immigrants avoided settling in the US South, which was a region that offered very few opportunities for upward mobility. Now let's look at the picture today. So here is the picture today. So today we have a better data. So we have data from Opportunity Insights data. So this is data from census records and from IRA, for tax returns. And again, on millions of immigrants. And what we find is that the children of poor immigrants today are more upwardly mobile than the children of US born from nearly every sending country. Now, unlike the past where we could only look at sons and men because of data limitations, today we can look at both the sons and the daughters of immigrants. So you can see on the left, you can see the sons of immigrants. On the right, you see the daughters of immigrants. And you can see that a similar picture emerges. Both the sons and daughters of immigrants are doing quite well. They are more likely than the children of US born to enter the middle class. So bottom line, the short-term view that politicians tend to take to on immigration undermines immigrant success. When we take a longer-term view, we see that the children of immigrants are doing quite well. Catching up might not occur within one generation, but it does by the second generation. And if anything about policy, I would say that it would be a mistake to determine immigration policy based on the belief that immigrants do not integrate into the US economy and US society. And this is just one of our findings. Anywhere we can look at, we find that immigrants are making substantial effort to join society and the economy, and they're doing quite great. All right. So, our next speaker is Anna Raquel Minian. Anna is an associate professor in the Department of History. She is a real expert on US immigration history and on modern Mexican history. Anna's first book is simply outstanding, and I highly recommend it to everyone here in the audience. It is an award-winning book titled Undocumented Lives, The Untold Story of Mexican Migration. It came with, I think, Harvard University Press in 2018. And in that book, Anna explains how unauthorized migration from Mexico to the United States became an entrenched phenomena in the years between 1965 and 1986. Anna is now working on her second book, No Man's Land, A New History of Immigration Restriction, and she's also writing a history about immigration detention in the United States, which she's going to talk to us about today. Now, one thing I admire about Anna is that in addition to writing such terrific scholarship, she always makes an effort to communicate her research with the public. She's writing quite regularly articles to the New York Times, Los Angeles Times, and The Atlantic. And she recently was awarded with the Andrew Carnegie Fellowship, which is a very prestigious fellowship awarded to exceptional scholars, journalists, and public intellects. So welcome, Anna, and I'm so happy that you could join us today.
Thank you, Ran, for that very beautiful introduction. Let me start. During the Trump administration, much concern has arisen about the conditions in immigration detention centers. First, we heard about children being separated from their families. Then we heard about children sleeping in kennels in freezing conditions. And only last month, we heard about women being subjected to forced hysterectomies while in detention. But while Americans have paid much attention to the conditions within immigration detention centers, few have questioned the very need for detention. Yet, not too long ago, the practice of detaining immigrants was not considered to be either normal or necessary. Today, I'm going to give you a brief history of this practice and how it changed over time. The United States first imposed immigration detention in the late 19th century. But by the early 1950s, detaining immigrants no longer seemed necessary. As we saw in the past presentation, in 1924, the United States imposed an immigration law that severely curtailed immigration from Asia and Europe. As such, few immigrants from these areas were coming. Similarly, in the 1930s, the Great Depression discouraged many people from coming to the United States. As a result, in 1954, officials from the Immigration and Naturalization Service concluded that they no longer needed to detain migrants. Most people, they argued, could be released on conditional parole while their cases were being reviewed. Detention, they held, was going to be reserved only for those people who were considered to be likely to abscond or who could pose a threat to the nation. In fact, by January 1955, only four people were in immigration custody. Reflecting on this change, in 1958, the Supreme Court held, and let me read, "The physical detention of aliens is now the exception, not the rule," and pointed out that certainly this policy reflects the humane qualities of an enlightened civilization. How is it that we as a society moved so far away from the notion that detention, and not just the separation of family and of children and their parents, of forced hysterectomies, but of detention as being inhumane? This change was prompted by the Mariel boat lift of 1980, when approximately 125,000 Cubans fled from Cuba to the United States in a highly politicized migration. Let me give you the example and the story of one of these migrants, whose name was Alberto Herrera. Born in Havana in 1952, Alberto Herrera was the eldest son of seven. Like many an elder son, he thought that he was responsible for the well-being of his family. But life in Cuba was hard and his family often went hungry. As a result, at the age of 18, Alberto decided to enter a government agency grocery store in Havana. He stole 2 pounds of cheese, put them under his jacket, and fled. But he did not make it out very far. He was caught and sentenced to 7 years in prison. After he completed his sentence, he was released. But of course, after having spent so much time in prison, finding a job was even harder than before. So only 5 months after he was released, he was caught and apprehended again, this time for trying to steal a pair of trousers. He was sentenced in 1979 to 13 years in prison. Now, in 1980, in the summer of 1980, his luck seemed to change. One day that summer, a guard from the prison came and told him that he was going to be placed on a boat headed to the United States. Alberto did not know it, but 2 months earlier, Fidel Castro had announced that any Cuban who wanted to leave the country could do so from the port of Mariel. Excited, their family members, who were already in Florida, Florida emigres, fled to the Mariel boat lift in boats and shrimpers to try to pick up their family members and take them back to the United States. But when they arrived to the port of Mariel to pick up their family members, the Cuban government informed them that if they wanted to take these people, they also had to take with them anyone that the Cuban government told them to take. On the returning boats, government officials placed some people who were mentally ill, as well as some who had been released from prison, including Alberto Herrera. As Alberto sailed toward Florida, he heard other people on his boat talking about Disneyland and about buying expensive cars. And he imagined a world in which he would finally be free and have a job. But when Alberto landed in Florida, his dreams of freedom sank. News had spread quickly throughout the United States that in these boats, Castro had placed mentally ill individuals and criminals. Americans faced extreme fear and started to demand the detention of these new arrivals. When Americans questioned Alberto, they determined that he had been imprisoned in Cuba and sent him, among other exiles considered to be criminals, to a federal correctional institution in Alabama. Thousands of other Cuban exiles who had not committed any crimes, and officials knew this, were placed in military bases throughout the country. There, the exiles had to wait to be sponsored either by a person, an American citizen, or by an American institution who promised to take care of them until these immigrants could take care of themselves. As the months went by, most of the 125,000 individuals who arrived got sponsored and left the camps. But those with no family members or acquaintance in the United States found it hard to be sponsored. After all, Americans feared them. This placed them in an impossible situation. Without having someone or something or some institution to sponsor them, these immigrants could not leave the camps. The only solution was to deport them. But the US government could not deport them because Castro's government refused to take them back to Cuba. These exiles were to remain in cages in the United States on an indefinite basis with no prospects of being set free. Few Americans protested. The practice of detention had come to be seen as necessary and is normal. By 1982, over 400 Mariel Cubans who had not been sponsored were sent to the federal maximum prison, maximum security penitentiary in Atlanta. There, they joined the ranks of other Mariel Cubans who had already committed crimes in the United States, often generally misdemeanors, as well as those who were believed to have committed crimes in Cuba, including Alberto Herrera. These people were to be held, the feeling was, in prison indefinitely until the Castro regime accepted to take them back. Now, the Mariel boatlift did not only expand immigration detention in the United States for the arriving Cubans, it also encouraged the US government to find ways to prevent another Mariel boatlift from ever happening again. First, US officials drafted plans to establish facilities throughout the country that could hold up to 20,000 immigrants in case another large migrant group arrived so that they knew where to hold them already. Then they also started to conceive of detention as a way of deterring migrants from ever setting sail. The idea was that if migrants believed that they would be detained when they arrived to the United States, they would never come in the first place. First, they introduced this policy with Haitians. Rather than offering them parole, as they had in the past, they simply detained them. By 1982, the US government formalized the practice of blanket detention and extended it to all migrants. What followed was a speedy race to build a massive detention infrastructure, which was often led by for-profit corporations, such as the Corrections Corporation of America. Indeed, the first private prison in the United States was an immigration detention center. It is because of this history that we now imprison thousands of undocumented migrants and asylum seekers at a cost of approximately $2.6 billion. However, it does not have to be like this. The history of immigration detention shows us that a more effective and humane way is possible. After all, in the years between 1954 and 1980, we already had such a system in place. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Anna. This was so insightful. And our next speaker is Asad Assad. Assad is an assistant professor of sociology at Stanford and a faculty affiliate at the Center for Comparative Studies in Race and Ethnicity. Assad's research agenda considers how U.S. immigration law and policy affect various forms of inequality. Assad is working on a book based on a 5 or 6 years study of Latino immigrant families in Dallas, Texas. He looks at how Latino immigrants with young US citizen children accumulate formal records as they go about their daily lives and what these records mean to people worried about government surveillance and ultimately deportation. Assad has also done research on the health consequences of deportation threat for immigrants, their families, and their communities. And he has also studied how federal judges make decisions on whether or not to denaturalize immigrants who have acquired US citizenship already. Assad has published many papers and his research has been supported by the National Science Foundation, the Russell Sage Foundation, and the Sperry Fund. His work has also received awards from the American Sociological Association, including the Lewis Wirth Award for Best Article given by the Section on International Migration. Welcome, Assad, and thanks a lot for joining.
Well, thank you for that kind introduction. It's a real pleasure to share this space with my fellow panelists. So let's just dive right in. Today, I'll share some insights from my book project on how immigrants experience the threat of deportation and what these thoughts and beliefs mean for how these individuals relate to American society. As an academic, I could talk about this for several hours, even days, but I'll just give you some of the highlights, but I'm happy to talk a little bit more about any point made during the Q&A. The first point I'd like to make is that for all of the scholarly and public emphasis on mass deportations, I'd argue that we're instead living in an era of mass deportability. By deportability, scholars refer to the possibility of deportation, of being kicked out of the country. And historically, deportations have targeted undocumented immigrants, those who for one reason or another lack authorization to be here. But all non-citizens, whether undocumented, visa holders, or lawful permanent residents, are deportable under US immigration law. And this reality isn't new either, but one that has become increasingly common due to changes in US immigration law and policy since the mid-1980s. Now, most of us are probably in agreement that non-citizens are deportable, particularly if you've been paying attention over the last several years. But I'd like you all to also think about US citizens as deportable as well. And if not deportable by themselves, then perhaps deportable through the effects of immigration law and enforcement. It's this reality that I'll cover in greater depth later on in the presentation that I like to call mass deportability, or how deportability, the possibility of deportation, ensnares non-citizens and US citizens alike, and how laws make this possibility more or less palpable for people's daily lives. The second takeaway, though, is that mass deportability doesn't affect everyone equally. It targets Latinos in this country, given a history of US economic and political interdependence or intervention or both in Mexico and Central America in particular. The numbers tell us just how targeted Latinos are. Latinos make up about 18% of the US population, and non-citizens make up about 7% of the US population. If Latinos are as deportable as other ethnic groups, then they should make up close to 18% of the non-citizen population. Instead, we see that they amount to about 57% of the non-citizen population vulnerable to deportation. But as we know, deportability and deportation are not the same thing. So maybe it's that Latinos are as represented in deportations as they are in their vulnerability to deportation. As it turns out, the answer is no, they are overrepresented relative to their share of the non-citizen population vulnerable to deportation. And non-citizens' deportability affects Latino US citizens as well. 28% of Latino US citizens in the country live with a deportable relative. That's about 5 million adults and almost 8 million kids. Now, the third takeaway I'd like to pass along to you all is that deportation fears are rightfully common among Latinos, but they are not universal. It's easy to get caught up in the idea that Latinos generally, and Latino immigrants specifically, are experiencing unprecedented deportation fears wrought by cruel policy choices coming out of the current presidential administration. And in fact, zooming in on the data would suggest that that might be the case. If we look at the black box, we see that there seems to be a Trump effect in reported deportation fears among Latino non-citizens in the red line and Latino US citizens in the blue line between 2016, when President Trump was elected, and 2018, about a year or so into his first term. And yet, in taking a longer view of deportation, we see a different reality for Latinos in the country that transcends the Trump administration. First, it's that since 2007, if you look at the red line over the blue line, Latino non-citizens have been more likely than US citizens who are Latino to report deportation fears. The red line is always higher than the blue line. But if we zoom in only on Latinos in the red box, we see that the trend over time is pretty flat. Non-citizens are no more or less likely to report fearing deportation now or in 2018 as they were in 2007. But if we look at US citizens in the blue box, the story has a bit more of a complicated story. But to summarize, and for greater depth, you can consult the article or ask about it in the Q&A, it's actually that Latino US citizens now fear deportation more than they did in 2007. That's the story of deportation fears that we should be telling. And if anyone is wondering, the story remains the same when we break down the data by undocumented immigrants, lawful permanent residents, naturalized citizens, and US citizens. Although unfortunately, I don't have a whole lot of time to talk about this. My research suggests a couple of possible explanations for these trends. First is that non-citizens have always been aware of their vulnerability to deportation. The policies of the Trump administration may feel especially cruel to the general public, but for non-citizens who have long coped with the threat of deportation, these policies are familiar. They're just another sort of line in the sand. And among US citizens, though, there are a few possible explanations. One is that US citizens who are immigrants may be worried about growing attempts to strip them of their acquired citizenship. This is a process known as denaturalization, which is not unique to the Trump administration, but that has become amplified under it. And the second possible explanation is that among all Latino US citizens is an awakening to the racist rhetoric and policies targeting Latino non-citizens that perhaps they paid less attention to under prior presidential administrations who were less explicit about their rhetoric or their intentions. These deportation fears matter. They can affect daily life in simple but profound ways, complicating things like school attendance, medical care, and even taking your pet to the veterinarian. Scholars often compare the situation of undocumented immigrants who are vulnerable to deportation to that of people who have criminal records. The logic is that people who fear law enforcement should fear involvement in societal institutions that keep formal records as a matter of course. So doctors' offices, banks, and schools and the workplace come to represent sites where formal records are gathered and pathways to deportation where law enforcement might find you. But, and this is my fourth takeaway, deportation fears don't work in straightforward ways. Between 2013 and 2018, I followed dozens of Latino immigrant families in Dallas, Texas, to study how they manage deportability and daily life. I found that even when the law threatens their long-term presence in this country, the families I spoke to found ways to carve spaces of inclusion within societal institutions. Sometimes this involvement signaled their respect for the law, such as when they apply for individual tax identification numbers from the IRS to file their taxes or open a bank account. Sometimes this involvement signaled their efforts to care for their US citizen children, for example, by taking their kids to the doctor's office or attending parent-teacher conferences. And sometimes this involvement signaled the exceptional hardship their deportation would entail for a spouse or child who is a citizen or permanent resident, such as engaging with social services to battle for the resources their children with disabilities deserve. This idea is also borne out in nationally representative data. And with the help of a wonderful Stanford sociology graduate student named Olivia Bayer-Bositis, we've calculated some numbers for you all. So the American Time Use Study asks people living in the US to keep a detailed diary of how they spend their time during the 24 hours preceding the survey. Each activity that they log in the diary is then grouped into different categories, which we then recategorized to correspond to surveilling institutions, which keep formal records like hospitals, banks, schools and the workplace and government services, and non-surveilling institutions, volunteering and church, places where you can enter and not give your name or your ID. And what we found is pretty remarkable. Looking at overall rates of involvement in surveilling institutions, we see a few things. First is that non-citizens in the green bar are less likely statistically than US citizens to spend time in surveilling institutions. But more than half of all non-citizens do participate on any given day in these surveilling institutions. And what we can't show here because of time constraints is that this pattern depends heavily on the type of surveilling institution. Although it is the case that non-citizens are less likely to spend time accessing medical and financial services, they are as likely to spend time at school and work and accessing government services, usually on behalf of their citizen children, as US-born citizens are. Now, we can show that this is not an anomaly because when we look at institutions that don't keep formal records, churches and volunteering, you actually see there's no significant difference in how involved non-citizens and US-born citizens are, suggesting that there's something about formal records and those institutions that matters more for how immigrant families think about the threat of deportation as they participate in American life. Overall then, in thinking about deportation threat and daily life, we need to remember that non-citizens and US citizens are both affected, but that Latino US citizens and non-citizens are most affected. And we should spend time identifying the laws and policies that make deportation threat a reality for so many Latino immigrants and non-immigrants in the country. But we should also spend time identifying how and why these individuals are able to resist unforgiving laws to carve out spaces for societal inclusion. And thank you so much for your time.
Well, thank you so much, Asad, for this great presentation. And our final speaker is my wonderful colleague and office neighbor under normal times, Melanie Morten. Melanie is an assistant professor in the Department of Economics here at Stanford, and she's a faculty fellow at the National Bureau of Economic Research and at the Stanford King Center on Global Development. Melanie is a development economist who built an important and focused research agenda on the causes and consequences of migration in developing countries. Melanie is asking some very important questions on immigration, for example, who decides to migrate and where? How do road networks and borders affect migration costs? What are the aggregate gains for migration? And what are the effects of migration on the sending and on the receiving communities? Melanie's research is published at the top economic journals, and she has received the prestigious Sloan Fellowship and an NSF Career Award, among other prizes. Now, Melanie and co-authors recently wrote a fabulous paper that estimates the consequences of building a wall on the border with Mexico. And this research has received a lot of attention in economics and from the media, and Melanie will tell us about it today. So welcome, Melanie, and thank you very much for being here.
Okay, well, thank you, Ryan, for that wonderful introduction. So the screen is shared? Okay, excellent. So this is a project that I wanted to talk about. And I'm gonna sort of, in the interest of time, talk about a fairly narrow part of it, which is what are the economic effects of building a wall? And so as economists, we can learn a lot about what we might think about policies from looking at policies that have been enacted in the past. So as everyone knows, there's an extremely large policy debate about whether or not the US should build a wall on the US-Mexico border. And if you think about the purely the economic questions that this brings up, there's sort of two key questions. First, would a wall actually change the migration patterns for people who are crossing the US-Mexico border? And second, if the wall did change migration patterns, would that lead to changes in the economy in the US? And in particular, the normal argument is that it might help, for example, low-educated Americans who may now have increased income. So what we did in this paper is we looked at the fact that about 5 years ago, the US actually already built a large proportion of wall on the US-Mexico border. And so we asked what happened to both migration patterns and to the economic effects when the US built this wall. So what was the wall expansion? The wall expansion was a policy called the Secure Fence Act. And this was a policy that was signed in by President Bush and continued by President Obama. And between the years 2007 and 2010, about 550 miles of additional fortification were built on the US-Mexico border. And so what happened is the border went from around about 5% of the border being covered to around about 40% of the border being covered in a very short period of time. At the same time that the wall was being built, the second phenomenon to have in the back of your mind is that the amount of migration to the US has been dramatically decreasing. So this picture on the right, which is showing the number of migrants, who have been in the US for less than 5 years, you can see from about 2005, this also sharply decreased. So what, around about 1.5 million migrants who had been recently in the country to just under 500,000 by the end of the period. So when you look at these two pictures juxtaposed like this, it suggests, is it the case that building a wall led to a decrease in migration? Or is it the case that there were other things that were happening in the US economy at the same time that might be explaining this change in migration? So what the goal of economists often is to think about how do you separate out and how can you isolate different things that might be causing patterns in the data that look like things might be co-moving. So for example, in this particular case, another very dramatic event that happened exactly at the same time was the Great Recession that led to a very large decrease in employment and jobs in the US as well. So what we do in this paper is we ask, how much did the wall explain of this aggregate migration pattern? And we're going to find that it's about 5% of the reduction is due to increased border fortification. The rest of this very dramatic decrease in migration patterns doesn't look like it's explained by actually making it more difficult to cross the border. So let me sort of talk through how we get to that answer. So as I talked about, the government or the US government built 550 miles of extra wall. And the idea here is that it's going to make some paths between Mexico and the US more difficult. But because it doesn't cover the complete border, there's going to be some paths along the border that were not particularly affected. We then want to ask, how did migration patterns change? And for that, we would ideally want to see exactly all of the migrants who were setting out to migrate across the border. Where did they start from in Mexico and where did they end up in the US? So it's very difficult to observe this because a lot of migration is unauthorized. So it's very difficult to see official data and official records. What we use in the paper is we use a confidential version of some government administrative data from the Mexican government that lets us see the birth origin of migrants and the destination county in the US. And what we see over this period is about 6 million observations of individuals who are migrating. And some of these migrants, this is an ID card that they apply for when they're in the US. Sometimes people are getting renewals of the card, so we can separate out people who look like they're first-time applicants for this matricula consular ID card versus people who are renewing the cards. And that's going to let us ask, how do migration patterns from specific origins to specific destinations change? And how did that change based on where on the border we would predict people to cross? And then whether or not that place along the border got a wall. So this is sort of some examples just to have a sense of what is going on. So the picture on the left is a pedestrian wall. While it's not a sort of 10-foot concrete barrier, you can see it's a fairly substantial barrier that's primarily built to stop and deter people crossing the border. This figure on the right is a vehicular wall that's primarily to stop cars. This is where the wall was built along the border. So before 2006, there were some portions of the border that are in the black hash marks that already had some sort of border fortification, primarily near larger cities. And then this very rapid increase of building the wall built along California, Arizona, and New Mexico. Most of the Texas border did not get a wall, primarily because there's already the Rio Grande and other geographical barriers. And as you can see, this was this very dramatic increase over a very short period of time. And then this is just sort of an image of showing some of the variation that we can then look at when we want to ask, how did migration patterns change? So this is a screenshot from Google Maps that shows the pedestrian wall running along the border. To the north is Mexico, and to the south is a small village. And you can see in this particular case that the wall runs and then basically stops. So then what we can look at is the migration data. So this is an example of the ID card. This is just an image from the Mexican government website. I want to emphasize that we have data that does not have any information about individuals' names. So we got a version of this database that's fully anonymized from the Mexican government. But what it does let us see is it lets us see this information about where the migrants were born, what municipality in Mexico. And then that lets us see the information. We don't have their actual address, but we have the county where they went to in the US. So, and we also have a little bit of the demographic information. So for example, how old people are, what their level of education is. So we don't have anything that lets us actually identify migrants, but we can see how many people are migrating between a particular municipality and a particular county. And we can see that over every year. And then we can ask, did those patterns change after the wall was built that might make it difficult to get between some origins and some destinations. So how do we construct that measure? So imagine this is the US-Mexico border. This is where the wall went. What we want to do is we want to classify locations along the border as either having a wall or having a not having a wall. And then we want to ask, imagine if you start in a location in Mexico and you want to go to a destination in the US, what would be the shortest way to get there? And then what would be the shortest way if you were trying to get there after the wall? And what that means is that there's going to be, because the policy is a spatial policy, there's going to be a lot of different heterogeneity and how difficult it was, for example, to get to San Francisco, depending where you were starting in Mexico. So this is an example of an origin destination pair that's very exposed. This is an example of a pair that's weakly exposed. And then this would be another example where, for example, if this was San Francisco, the wall shouldn't have had any effect on the difficulty to get to that location. So we then ask, how did migration patterns measured by the issuance of these cards correlate with our predicted change and how difficult it was to travel between that origin and that destination? So on the y-axis here, we're plotting the change, the percentage change in the number of cards issued. And on the x-axis here, we're plotting how costly do we think it became to migrate particularly between that origin and destination pair. So what you can see is that there's a downward slope there. That suggests that people did respond to the wall. So when it got more difficult to migrate between a certain origin and destination, we see relatively fewer people appearing in that destination from that origin. The second thing to notice is that the average cost is not very high. On average, it's only about a 3% increase in migration costs. This is sort of from two factors. One is that the wall had many gaps in it, so it wasn't that much of a difficulty to go around. The second was when we actually calculate how responsive migration patterns are to the presence of a wall, we get numbers that suggest that people, it's not that difficult, and that's sort of borne out by lots of anecdotal evidence about breaches of the wall and the fact that you can climb over. But when you look at this question here, or this pattern, you see a downward slope. This doesn't let us answer whether or not people stopped migrating altogether or just substituted, and instead of going, for example, to San Francisco, maybe went to Texas. So this tells us kind of relatively that people were less likely to go to a destination if there was a wall, but it doesn't tell us anything about overall, did migration go up or go down? And then it also doesn't tell us anything about the next question, which is, was this good or was this bad for wages and for US workers? So what we do in the rest of the project is we sort of ask those questions. What do we think might happen to wages? How do we think about how likely people are to migrate at all? What do we think about understanding the different and effects on different workers? And when we do that exercise, what we end up with is we end up predicting that if you didn't take into account any of the other changes that were happening in the economy, we would get this first number, a reduction of about 50,000 people per year. Once you take into account what might happen in terms of wages going up in the US, that might induce people to still migrate even if you have to cross the wall to get there, we get a slightly lower number of about 46,000 people fewer per year. But what I sort of also want to emphasize is that our estimated economic effects on US workers are very, very minimal. So we predict that although there was a reduction of about 47,000 workers per year, that's about 5% of that overall fall, we predict that that led to only a $3 average increase in income per year for US workers without any college education. And if you think about it, what this also is going to have done, and this comes from kind of relative scarcity in the labor market, everyone else loses money. So for example, US workers with a college degree, we predict lose about $4. So this $3 gain also should be benchmarked against the fact that it costs $7 per person to build this wall construction. So what that means is that even for the people in the economy who benefited the most, they would have been better off receiving the $7 construction cost than getting that $3 indirect effect through the economy. So where does this lead us? As an economist, we can think about what do we learn from policies and what can we look at about the responsiveness for how people make migration decisions. And for that, you need to think both about getting ways to measure the impact, as well as, in our case, using economic theory to think about how do we understand how people might make decisions about trading off do they stay at Mexico or do they migrate or do they go to a just a different destination in the US? When we do that, we find that in this previous experience of building a wall, we do see migration response. However, migration responds fairly small, to a small amount, it's only about 5% of that overall reduction. And we see essentially zero effect on the wages of US workers. And so this may give us some pieces of empirical evidence as we think about the economic consequences and whether or not this is a policy that makes sense purely on economic terms for the future. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Melanie. That was really fascinating and a great session. And let's now turn to questions from the audience. And today I want to invite Kelsey, a bright junior undergraduate student here at Stanford, studying international relations and minoring in human rights. I first met Kelsey when she took my freshman seminar on immigration in the United States a couple of years ago, and she's now working with me as my research assistant and doing such a wonderful job, and it's such a pleasure to work with her. Kelsey is very interested in immigration. She has interned at a legal services organization that support asylum seekers at the border and is currently an intern at the Democracy, Human Rights and Labor Bureau of the U.S. State Department. And so thank you very much, Kelsey, for agreeing to moderate the Q&A today.
Thank you, Ron. So this first question is actually for you. What are some public misunderstandings or misperceptions surrounding immigration to the U.S. that your research has uncovered?
Oh, that's an excellent question. There are some things that we are able to cover better than other things. So, for example, we are able to look at misperception about how immigrants are doing in the economy and in the labor markets. We are able to look even at how immigrants are doing more broadly in society, you know, whether this perception that they are not even trying to integrate, well, we find is not true. They apply for citizenship. Many of them marry with others from outside of their groups. There are many ways in which we can measure. But, you know, at the end of the day, government documents like the censuses are not something that record the full experience of immigrants. And that's why it is so important to work on this alongside reading very carefully work like that of Asad and that of Anna from other disciplines and learn about the richer immigration experience. There are some things we are kind of trying to push ourselves to do. For example, we want to know how the perception of immigrants changed over time. So we collected this data on 2000 interviews, in-depth interviews that were recorded in Ellis Island, trying to see how immigrants perceive their own experience. We are trying to analyze things like the New York Times and congressional speeches over the last 150 years to see how the perception of immigrants changed over time. But all of this quantitative work always have to be together with qualitative evidence and with historical work, and only that way we can look at the full perception and what part of it is right and wrong.
Great, thank you so much. The second question is for Professor Minian. What happened ultimately with the Cuban immigrants who came during the Mariel boat lift, and were the majority of them able to build lives here in the US?
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. Yes, the majority were able to live life, to build a life in the United States. Most of them were not arrested. Most of them were placed in the camps, as I originally said, but then were released and lived a life in the United States. Now, what happened to those who were arrested was that in 1987, Mariel Cubans who had by then often been like 7 years, some of them in prison and had no expectation of getting out. They were indefinitely in prison. Decided to protest. And by then they were imprisoned primarily in the Atlanta penitentiary, which was a maximum security penitentiary, and in a new prison built specifically for them in Oakdale, Louisiana. And what happened was that in 1987, they set the prisons on fire and created a huge protest. They also took captives. And so with these protests and the experience of what happened with what had recently happened in the prison in Attica, where a lot of prisoners were killed after they protested, after they rioted. The Immigration Service agreed to review each of their cases individually. This had never happened before. And after that, they were released, at least the people who had been imprisoned between 1980 and 1987. Now, those who were imprisoned again, those who were imprisoned after 1987, once again, fell into permanent detention and were not released until 2015, when the Supreme Court argued that that permanently imprisoning someone who had no way of getting out, and not because of the crime they had committed, but because in the United States, if you commit a crime or if you're imprisoned and you're an immigrant, you're not allowed back into the country if you haven't become a citizen, that they couldn't be deported, right? So they were in this impossible situation. And in 2015, the Supreme Court said that it was illegal to place immigrants in this impossible situation. And if they were going to be in permanent detention for not for committing a crime, but because they were in this situation, they had to be released. That being said, the following year in 2016, the Obama administration made a deal with Cuba. And Cuba, because it renewed relations, and Cuba agreed to take many of these Mariel detainees who had since then committed often very minor crimes in the United States back. So for example, I interviewed someone who had been caught with less than an ounce of marijuana at a party, had been imprisoned in 1983, released in 1987 after the prison riots, and then in 2016, had rebuilt his life, had American children, had an American wife. And in 2016, he was basically ordered to go back to Cuba. He was deported in 2017 and died in Cuba only 2 years later of cancer, because in Cuba, no one was treated him because he was also considered to have been a reject of society. So the stories of Mariel Cubans is sometimes very hard. Now, for the majority of them, they have managed to come to the United States and build a very happy life here.
Super fascinating. Thank you, Professor Minian. This question is for Professor Asad. Can you talk more about the conditions under which Latino US citizens can be deported?
Yeah, so first of all, historically, during between the 1920s and the 1940s, there was a forced repatriation campaign of a lot of Mexican-looking people who lived near the border. And that ultimately got many people who were Mexican U.S. or of Mexican descent, but U.S.-born citizens forcibly repatriated to Mexico, despite them being U.S.-born citizens. Now that said, these days, the likelihood of someone who is actually a U.S.-born citizen being formally deported is sort of out of the question, with the exception of someone who is an immigrant who has become denaturalized. And you can become denaturalized or stripped of your US citizenship if the federal government deems you to have violated some aspect of immigration law or misrepresented some aspect of your naturalization application in a criminal offense within 10 years of naturalization. Although in civil court, you can basically do that whenever. There's no statute of limitations in a civil court. With the graduate student Cassandra Roser, as well as a really wonderful undergraduate RA named Caitlin Zhu, we went through a lot of these decisions over the summer, and we found that people were denaturalized for all kinds of reasons, ranging from having given a wrong name or identity at the time that they entered the country, even though they might have been deported having previously entered under a different identity, years ago. There was the case of a woman who lived in the United States as a US citizen for 15 years, but for some reason or another was ordered denaturalized because the federal government identified her as having lied about whether she had ever been arrested. They accused her of lying, she just might have forgotten. And so these are the kinds of things that we're dealing with today. And I should also point out that there's a growing body of research in sociology and demography that suggests that a lot of US-born children who are Latino are actually living in Mexico now. So I think the last estimate was about 500,000 children who were born in the United States living in Mexico. And it's not because they're on, you know, they decided to move to Mexico by themselves, but it's because something happened to their parents, probably deportation, that ultimately led them to having to live in Mexico. Otherwise, they would be separated from their parents. It's another way to get at Professor Minian's sort of a commentary about family separation at the border, right? There's also family separation outside of the United States happening. And in order to combat that, families decide to sort of opt out of the United States, even though they're entitled to the rights and privileges of being here. And that's not, you know, happening in immigration court, but it is a product of the way we've enforced federal immigration laws, right? And so this is why we have to sort of contextualize the statistics that we have available, because you won't find, you know, US citizens who are deported very, you know, they're not going to be in deportation statistics, but they will be in the Mexican census, the INEGI, and it will tell you that, you know, there's 500,000 kids who were born in the United States who now live in Mexico. Is that deportation? Not legally. Is it a de facto deportation as a result of the consequences of federal immigration enforcement on these kids' parents? I would think so.
Oh, thank you so much, Professor Asad. And this question is for Professor Morten. So can you talk about how both major political parties in the US have contributed to building the border wall over time? And in other words, it's not just conservatives who are building the wall, but it's over the span of various presidential administrations.
So I think I can talk about the specific policy that we looked at, which was the Secure Fence Act. And there's sort of been a very long history of different periods of different operations to think about putting putting up fortifications on the border. So the Secure Fence Act was signed in 2004 by President Bush, and then it was continued. The last part of it went into the first sort of, it was building in the period where Obama was the president. So he continued that policy. What's quite interesting is if you look back, for example, on the congressional debates about having building a border wall, is you can look back at the different arguments that senators are making about whether or not this is going to be something that is effective. And if it's not, there, I think, as an economist, you know, I don't think we have too much to say other than we can look at, say, what were the arguments for, what were the arguments against. The arguments for and against, the arguments for are usually that it would stop people from migrating. So we can ask, did it stop people from migrating? And we can look and see if what empirical evidence we can find for that. The arguments against, and if you go back through and read some of the congressional debates, you sort of see people, we have some quotes of this in the paper if you want to look at sort of the end. People sort of saying, you know, it seems obvious that if you look at past periods where we've built walls, people just react by diverting and crossing the border elsewhere. Lots of these issues were raised. So I think in this particular case, this was a policy that was passed under President Bush, but it was continued by President Obama. And, you know, then we can ask, did it work? Did it not work? And, you know, our paper sort of suggests that it was an expensive policy that had very little effect on actually discouraging migration and little effect on changing the economic conditions. That might be a useful impact in the future when we want to do evidence-based policies. Whatever the party who is implementing the policy, they can look and say, what evidence do we have that this might work or not work?
Anna, I wonder if you maybe can chime in here and say a few words. You talked today about the immigration from Cuba, but you are like also like a world expert on the Mexican undocumented immigrants. And like in light of what Asad and Melanie were talking about, I wonder if you can maybe tell us a few words maybe on like the main insight that you have from your first book that is related to the questions that we are talking about here today.
Yeah, thank you, Ren. So I agree with everything that both of them have said. And in particular, what I want to stress is that what Professor Morten is talking about goes back way earlier. So just to give a brief history of Mexican migration starts in the late 19th century and then continues, and it primarily takes the form of circular migration, where it is primarily men who come, They come, they work in the United States for short periods of time, and then they return to Mexico. And this was formally implemented through a program that started in the Second World War called the Bracero Program, because Mexican men were supposed to come and work in farm work with their arms, with their brazos, as it's called in Spanish, so the Bracero Program, where again, men would come, work legally for short periods of time, and then return to Mexico. Now, the idea that many Mexican men had was that whenever they returned to Mexico, if they needed work again, they would simply come back to the United States only to start the process again. So what we had was, up until 1986, most Mexican migration took place in a circular fashion. Now, the Bracero program ended in 1964, but the pattern of circular migration continued. Mexican men still came. They had no interest of residing permanently in the United States. They returned to Mexico, where their families were. Now, in 1986, something very similar to the process that Professor Morten is describing occurred, which was that in 1986, the US Congress passed a new law called the Immigration Reform and Control Act. And one of the things that this law did was that it fortified the US-Mexico border, which made it much harder for people to come and go between Mexico and the United States, because it was much harder to enter. First, deaths at the border increased dramatically as people moved to areas where the border hadn't been fortified, but that were very hard to cross because there was a desert where there's rattlesnakes, where people die of heat. So people started to find it very hard to engage in this process of circular migration, of coming and going, because A, they had to pay much more for a smuggler to cross them, and B, they risked their lives. So what happened was that after 1986, we see the pattern of circular migration stop. Mexican men, accustomed to coming and going between Mexico and the United States, without any way of getting a job and opportunities in Mexico, because the law had not changed what was happening in Mexico, decided to come to the United States one more time. But this time, they did not return back to Mexico. Instead, they encouraged their families, their wives and children, who had traditionally stayed in Mexico, to come alongside with them. What did this mean? It meant that a law that fortified the border, and it fortified it not necessarily through a wall, but through increased patrolling and new technologies in the border to catch the immigrants. This 1986 law fortified the border. And what it did was that now people who had come and gone stayed in the United States, and people who had never come, women and children, now started migrating. So the population of immigrants, of undocumented immigrants residing in the United States, actually increased dramatically as a result of the fortification of the border in 1986. The policy was extremely counterproductive to what it intended to create, which was reducing undocumented migration.
Thank you so much. This question is for all the panelists to respond to. What do you think is the most effective path toward a more compassionate immigration policy?
Asad, why don't we start with you?
That's a big one. I think, you know, so compassionate is unfortunately is a politicized word. What it means to be compassionate depends on your perspective in politics. And what I believe to be compassionate as someone who studies these ideas close up might be very different from what political officials in Washington believe to be compassionate. So a few things that I think would be easy, you know, giant easy fixes. First is, you know, Professor Minian did a beautiful job explaining how we went from a population of circular migrants who didn't live in the US to a settled population of families who now live in the US. I think it would be irresponsible to continue to pass the buck on a legalization program for 11 million undocumented immigrants who are living in the United States. Many of them have been here for well over 10 years, and they are American in every way that they could possibly be, with the exception of citizenship. And I think it's time to put them on a journey toward legalization and toward citizenship. But I would say one of the sort of flows from Mexico to the United States have slowed. flows from Central America to the United States have increased. I would say one other big change that we could make is to decriminalize undocumented border crossings. It used to be the case that if you got caught once, you'd get sent back. And if you got caught again, you just get sent back with no jail time. And that policy changed I think it was in the 80s, maybe in the 90s. And now if you get caught a second time, you're actually, you face prison time in addition to sort of a 10-year bar for accessing visas and other immigration benefits. And yet sort of the conditions that prompted you to migrate haven't changed. And so the idea that, you know, you'd be turned back after you're released from prison and yet you're still facing the same issues that led you to migrate in the first place. You now live in the United States with a criminalized status because you keep trying to enter the country is sort of counterproductive, I would argue. And so it's probably best to have a policy that's more aligned with both the realities of sending countries, right? It's just true that people from Mexico and Central America have greater demand for visas than, say, somebody from, you know, Western Europe who is looking to come to the United States on vacation, right? A tourist visa is not the same thing as a work visa for a low-skilled worker, for example, who's trying to live and work here with their family. And so I would say that, you know, a legalization program for undocumented immigrants and decriminalizing undocumented border crossings is a good place to start, although immigration policy is many other things that we could talk about, and I'll yield the floor to my co-panelists.
So yeah, we really only have 1 minute left, but I see that Anna really wants to say something. So Anna, just be brief so that we can finish.
Sure, I will be very brief. I completely agreed with what has just been said. I will just add a couple of things. First is we have to think about why people are coming. People often want to stay in their home countries and can't. And when we think of immigration policy independently of other US policies that have driven people to migrate, we are doing a great disservice both to the United States and to the people. So for example, Central Americans often came to this country because of the dirty wars that were sponsored by the United States. In Mexico, people left in the 1940s, as I said, with the Bracero program, in part because the United States had sponsored the Green Revolution. And the Green Revolution did a lot of wonders for the Mexican countryside. It brought in fertilizers, it irrigated the land, but it also meant that a lot of farm workers lost their jobs. And while this policy was implemented, no other policy was implemented to go hand in hand to provide jobs for those people. So of course they were gonna migrate. So part of what I'm trying to say is, when we're thinking about immigration, we also have to think about why people leave and the policies of the United States that have also encouraged these ones go hand in hand. And in terms of legalization that Asad was talking about earlier, I just want to add that of course the people who are here need to be legalized. Not just for them, but for the welfare of the United States. When people legalized their status in 1986, IRCA, the Immigration Reform and Control Act, also allowed 3.2 million people who had been here for over 5 years to legalize their status. And what we can see is that those people were able to get better paying jobs. They were able to buy homes. Of course, why would they buy homes beforehand if they were scared of being deported? And all of this investment that they did in the economy was actually very beneficial both for them and for the United States as a whole.
Well, so much more to say, but time is up. And this has been a really wonderful discussion. And thank you very much, Anna and Asad and Melanie, for your great presentations. And thank you, Kelsey, for moderating the Q&A so well. And thank you all for joining and for asking such good questions. And as always, I will make available a list of readings for the students based on today's presentations. And I'll see you all next week. We will talk about racial injustice.